This is the Blaring Out with Eric Blair show, and today I'm pleased to have my Chemical Romance on the show, Gerard Way and Mikey Way. How you guys doing today?
Great. How you doing?
Awesome.
Doing very well.
You're right on. Three cheers for sweet revenge.
This record is more about losing women than removing women violently. This record's really not about relationships. The last one was more about relationships. This one's more about like loss and losing people and kind of trying to get people back and willing to do anything to be with that person again.
A lot of times in relationships, we're almost blinded to the fact that maybe that person wasn't that good for us anyways. But you want them back. Sometimes you get them back and you're in a bad position.
Yeah, I mean, I think most of the friends I've had, a lot of people have been really blinded in relationships. They don't really realize how awful of a relationship they've been in, and it takes them a long time. Like, sometimes it takes them getting out of it. Like, Mikey's been in some that, you know, it took him like some waking up to get out of, and he's so much happier now. Yeah, sometimes you get them back and you go through hell to get them back, and this record's kind of like that. Like, this guy wants this girl back, and they've been separated by death, and so he's willing to do whatever it takes to get her, and in the end, when he does get her back, it's really not what he hoped. The album is it's roughly half a concept and half about our lives. Started off as a full concept, really just ended up, so much stuff happened in our lives that we ended up writing about that.
And we kind of had this rough idea to make this concept record about, like, you know, make like a rock opera sort of thing. And I think so many factors in our own life kind of intertwine into the story. So now it's like, it's hard to really like differentiate between the concept and the you know, like, what's part of the story and what's part of our lives. So, I mean, I don't know. It's kind of like, it's fun, you know, people, like, would, you know, get their own kind of, like, get their own story out of it. And we don't really want to, like, say what part's our concept or what part's the, you know, the concept of the story. Because I think it's just more fun that way.
It must be fun for you guys to have fans come up after the shows and go, this song really means this to me.
The coolest thing that ever happened, was the first time it ever happened, was the head of our street team, Carlos, who we love very, very much. He was really our first fan. He was our first big fan. And he IM'd me one day on the computer, and I didn't know who he was. And he said that Vampires Will Never Hurt You, off the first record, to him, it was helping him get through high school, because he saw all these people that were, you know, kind of, I guess, not so much jocks and stuff, but just people that were picking on him and stuff. And it actually kind of scared me when I first heard it. And I was like, oh, man, people are going to start thinking people are vampires and they're going to try to shoot them with shotguns. And I got kind of scared about all that. But, you know, it ended up, it just helped him get through a really bad relationship where a girl was jerking him around in high school and all the people that picked on him. And so, you know, that obviously the song is about being an alcoholic, but not to him, you know, and that's the coolest part.
The tour highlights so far.
Let's see.
We played in a rodeo in Odessa, Texas.
Yeah, that was huge.
That's huge, yeah.
Yeah, we played this, like, just middle of nowhere rodeo, you know. Some of the cooler shows, I think, this tour's been awesome. All the bands are great. Like, Story of the Year, Lost Prophets, and Letter Kills. Letter Kills is a great new band, too.
Yeah.
Some of the cooler shows have been, like, we've done these kind of weird, on the days off, we've gone and played our own, and they've been really fun, you know. They've just been smaller, more intimate, packed, sweaty, good times, you know. And these are great, though, because we're reaching so many different people on this tour. It's like playing a larger Warped, in a way.
How do you feel this compares to the Warped tour?
I think it's pretty similar. I mean, it's obviously separated by the fact you're playing inside venues with lights, and we like that a lot much better. You have really good, you know, your monitors are good on Warped, but they usually get blown around by the wind.
Okay.
And here that doesn't happen. And so you have very good stage sound on this tour. It's very pro. That's what's different. Otherwise, the crowd feels about like the same as a Warped crowd, you know. Just a lot of people that really want to hear new music.
That's awesome. Yeah, and you guys are kind of in this wave, this forefront of a wave of music that's happening right now, and a lot of people are calling it new metal, a lot of people are calling it emo. What is your whole interpretation of that?
I think labeling is a way of people very easily categorize things, and they kind of, I feel that they feel they need to do it. We've always considered ourselves a rock and roll band, even from beginning. Probably in the start, more of a punk rock band, and this time, with this record, we've really tried to step it into more of an arena rock sound. while still keeping that aggression of the punk rock. It's really hard to say for us. I've been calling it neo-death because it's so dark. Mm-hmm. It's this new kind of death rock. And that's just generally what I've been calling really violent pop music, stuff like that.
But at the same time, Mikey, you guys are very melodic, like you're saying, violent pop music, mm-hmm. You know? You're very melodic. Where does that come from?
I think that, like, the whole, like, you know, this optimistic kind of pop music, I mean, what me and Gerard would listen to when we were younger is kind of, like, more, like, kind of ironic pop, like The Smiths and Depeche Mode.
Yeah.
And bands like that were kind of, like, we're writing these extremely happy-sounding songs, but the message inside is just really bleak. And, I mean, that's how we kind of got our thing, you know? Like, we just love that. It's, like, tongue-in-cheek.
Yeah,
it's really cool.
Black humor in our music, and I think that's what makes the pop so on pop about it, you know, but it still sounds great to us. It's really catchy. We love catchy stuff.
What was high school like for you guys?
My high school life was kind of rough. I was a very overweight kid. Like, I was extremely, I was an introverted kind of guy, you know, like, I didn't actively go out and, like, seek friends or acceptance or anything. I mean, I'm sure you hear that from most people that are in bands, but I got what I got out of high school, and I think a lot of positive came from it, but I mean not in like a social setting, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was more of like a, I kind of found out how to deal with things, you know what I'm saying, as opposed to like making friends with people.
Yeah, kind of taught us both coping skills.
Teaches you some life lessons.
Yeah, like a crash course and being lonely and stuff. Both of us were pretty non-existent in high school. We're just that kind of the kid in the background all through high school, didn't hang out with kids from our own high school, weren't involved in any kind of school activities. We thought that stuff was lame and, you know, always the kid sitting alone at the pep rally or the lunch table. So we actually were in high school together for 1 year because we're 3 years apart. So that was a pretty cool year. That was a fun year for both of us, I think.
Believe it or not, man, high school is like that for me, too.
Yeah, I mean, I think
it's like that with everybody.
Gravitate towards rock and roll and being involved in movies, writing novels, any kind of creative process. You probably were a loner in high school. You probably didn't have any friends, and you probably lived in your head all day. And I think, you know, that's why, you know, guys like you and guys like me and Mikey and my band get involved with this thing is to kind of, in a way, it's like revenge, you know, which is why we titled the record that. It's like our way of being finally heard or getting back, you know, for being, like, so quiet all those years.
How was the music scene in New Jersey when you guys were coming up?
It was pretty huge. I mean,
there's this huge, this kind of, it kind of moves in waves from, like, one state to the next, you know, like, Jersey in, like, what, the late 90s was pretty big, and, then it moved to Long Island, and now I think it's coming back to Jersey.
I think it's pretty much now, like, the whole tri-state area.
Tri-state, yeah.
It's like, you know, like, you got Long Island and New York City and New Jersey and Philadelphia and just kind of all the, you know, even upstate New York, there's all these bands coming out of there now. And when we were coming up, it was just starting to be more than Jersey. It was, you heard about bands from Long Island coming up. There was a lot of bands trying new things. There's a lot of bands kind of sounded the same. I think more bands sounded the same, and I think what's what made certain bands easier for them to break out of the scene is if they were different at all. And we really didn't fit in very early on in the local Jersey scene, which was cool to us.
Yeah.
And you know, and you could always tell who was coming to see us because it was like the two kids that didn't look like anybody else at the show. They had no idea what a scene was, and they just, you know, heard about us probably from the internet, and it was always like the loner kids, and they were always alone.
Was the scene grueling for you guys in the beginning?
It wasn't grueling. Like, in fact, from our very first show on, it was pretty much, until there started to be a buzz, it was, you know, people, like, loved us. And then, you know, everybody started saying, oh, you got to see this band, you got to see this band. And it's very cool to not like what everybody else likes. So there was never an anti-MyChem thing in Jersey.
We kind of had a lot of support from some of the bands that were that are still prominent from New Jersey, you know what I'm saying? Like, Thursday and Midtown really, like, helped us out when we were, like, just starting out in New Jersey, which is cool because they kind of helped get our name out, you know.
It was very, yeah. What was cool about, you know, those bands admiring us and helping us was, they accepted us as one of them. And these were huge bands, and we were this baby, kind of a VFW hall band,
yeah.
And they had already accepted us as one of them, and it was just really cool to be part of that. That ilk, you know, it was great.
People think that, you know, a lot of times it's easy to be accepted into certain circles like that, but it's not, because you don't choose to put yourself there. Those people choose to put you there.
Yeah, like it's kind of like, and it's not clicky at all. It's just that genuinely these dudes are all great dudes, and they just like great music, and they like stuff that's different, but that feels like their camaraderie with, and we all felt a camaraderie with Thursday in Midtown.
Were your family supportive of your decision to pursue music?
They've always been supportive of me and Mikey. All of our families were really supportive, but they were all really scared. I was like 24 at the time. I had tried other things in my life that had failed. I was always coming up with some kind of crazy scheme or something I knew I was going to do with my life. I'm going to do this now, or I'm going to mow lawns, or I'm going to write books, or whatever. And I pulled Mikey out of school, too, for this. So,
which I kind of went to college as a means to meet someone to start a band, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was like, yeah, this is how you go out and meet people that, you know, you have similar interests with. I didn't really have any, you know, interest in what I was doing in school. I'm not saying school's bad. Stay in school.
That's actually how Midtown started, was they all met in college.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
None of them really wanted to be
in college.
I thought
that's how it went. Yeah, I was like, go to college, I'm going to find some guys that like the same kind of music, and we're going to jam, you know?
Okay, so then how did My Chemical Romance come to be?
Well, basically, I was doing like artwork at the time, and I was out of college. I was kind of really going nowhere, just living. I was like being really like a hermit in my mom's basement. And I said, you know, I really want to see the world, because I have a feeling if I stay in Jersey, I'm never going to get out of here. And I called basically everybody in turn, in a way, made a demo. Mikey heard it. Mikey was kind of, he had no idea what was really going on, that I was starting a band, or maybe not so much that, but that it was serious and that I really wanted to do it, because I had tried so many different things. He was probably like, oh, he's going to just get bored of this in a month. And then he heard the demo, and he wanted to be part of the band, and then he learned the songs in like a week. He rocked out with us, and right before we made our first record, we got Frank, because his band had dissolved, and that was the unit, you know, and we stayed that way as that lineup for, I guess, 2.5 years, 2 years.
Yeah, two and a half years.
And then we got Bob, who's our new drummer from Chicago, and we love him very much.
Cool.
It's awesome.
Now, tell me, how did the deal, your first deal with Eyeball Records, come about in 2002?
It was pretty much like we had known Alex. He had made a habit of not signing friends' bands. That was kind of his policy. And me and Mike were friends with him. He heard we were playing one night, so he came to check us out, and he loved it so much. He said, well, you know, I don't usually do this, but I'd love to put this out. And we kind of all just did it together at that point, and Jeff had heard it, and Jeff wanted to produce it. It was just like a group effort all around the board, you know. And that's how that happened, the Eyeball thing.
Thursday's lead singer, Jeff Rickley, produces I Brought You My Bullets, You Brought Me Your Love.
Vocals were huge. Like, that was the biggest thing. He had just made 2 records. So he already had that studio experience, whereas we had never been in a studio. He was really good with working with our engineer, John Naclario. He really taught me a lot about kind of like emoting and like singing in a certain way where it would, like, he would ask me, well, you're saying this line. Does this line mean anything to you? Or what do you want to mean by this line? Like, you're really saying this, so why don't you deliver it in such a way? He taught me about holding back a lot, because I was just always going over the top, you know. And he was great vocally, and he had production ideas too, like Early Sunsets Over Monroeville, where he would, you know, he had me record the vocals 2 separate times, and we split them in each channel. Like, just, he had cool ideas, you know. It was basically like hanging out with one of your best friends for 2 weeks and making a great record.
You know? How do you feel 3 Cheers for Sweet Revenge differs from your last album?
We decided to take a lot of risks on this record by not holding ourselves back at all, and really not trying to do what we did at all on the first record. Just keep the basic elements, because if you listen to the first record, all that's really there is the basic elements. It's a band still trying to figure out who it is. And then when we toured, we figured out who we were. And so we're like, let's just keep these 5 components in place and really write great songs instead of trying to prove something or, you know, being very self-indulgent, you know. I think the songs are way better. The production, obviously, is...
Smoking.
Yeah, it's like, you know, we had a week to do the first one, basically 9 days. And this one we had months and money and...
So now Howard Benson gets an idea to put you in a dark attic to do vocals.
Yeah.
What did you learn about yourself from this experience?
I learned that I do actually sing better in a closed off environment like that. I was worried about the attic because I'm not claustrophobic or anything, but I was worried that I'm such a show off and I like to perform. That I'd always done my vocals like that, behind glass, looking at the producers, looking at the people, waiting for the reaction, kind of out of my peripheral vision. I was really worried. And I got up there in the first 2 weeks were really hard, getting used to it. And then I actually recut half the record. In the attic. I had sung about half the record in the attic. And then one day I kind of had a breakthrough, and we did the whole thing again. So we had redone the whole record, whatever we did up to that point.
Energy you have at that moment is caught on tape. Yeah. And a lot of times if you try to redo it, you can't, but you didn't find that to be a problem.
Not at all. I was not worried at all because I would listen to the stuff I had done, and he goes, well, just come down here and listen to it, see if you're comfortable with it. And I would listen to it, and I was like, no, this isn't working at all. And then I said, let's do the whole thing again. And we started next day. We started right away. I actually started that night, and I'm very happy we did it that way.
Now tell me about your love for bands like The Misfits, The Cure, The Smiths, and even Iron Maiden.
Yeah, I mean, I think the one thing you'll find about everybody in this band is that we have such a broad spectrum of musical tastes. So many that we're able to kind of squeeze it all and get the juice out of all of them and just kind of make this one mix, you know. And it's a very interesting mix. It gives us our sound, you know, and it's what always is going to keep us sounding like My Chemical Romance, no matter what kind of song we write. You know, the Misfits were huge to me. Iron Maiden was huge because that was the first band I had ever loved on my own, and then Misfits were the first punk rock band, and then the Smiths were the first British band, and it all kind of evolved, you know. Cure being like the first kind of new wave goth band that I liked, and me and Mikey generally were always on the same musical path. The other guys had been into metal, classical guitar, Black Flag. Frankie comes from more of the, you know, the older hardcore, punk hardcore scene.
You have this ability with your vocals to be able to sing in a real punk rock way, but then also get a clean sound out too, which really, you know, changes it up a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I generally just... I let the vocals, melodies, and the styles be really controlled by the emotion of what's happening at the moment. So it's kind of frantic. It's all over the place. But, I mean, you could always tell it's the same singer. And, yeah, I like to be able to actually sing sometimes, too, instead of just yelling, barking out stuff.
Who's the main lyricist in the band, or does everybody add input?
They let me write all lyrics, which is awesome. I use them as kind of my BS detectors, and I'm like, does this sound like corny? And I'll always run the lyrics by them, but they let me write them all, which is awesome.
What inspires your lyrics?
Well, stuff from my childhood, like a lot of horror movies, a lot of comic books, stuff from my life, like being in a band, past experiences, real life tragedies, stuff that has happened to other people, the supernatural, so many different things. Death is the biggest influence, I think, lyrically. Other lyricists I'm inspired by, like Tom Waits and Nick Cave, two biggest lyricists for me, and Morrissey, obviously. So much black humor in there.
And also very poetic.
Yeah, he's extremely poetic, you know, and Glenn Danzig and Bruce Dickinson, basically all the singers from the bands that inspired me.
Let's talk about your new album. Sure. Three Cheers for Sweet Revenge. Never had that sweet revenge. Never felt like I really saw anybody really get what they deserved, you know?
That's part of the problem.
Yeah.
I think is that nobody really gets what they deserve.
Yeah.
And this record's very much like that.
On the cover here, what is going on? I mean, you have, it looks like a couple, but they look like they've been cut up pretty bad.
Well, it's inspired by this Magritte painting. I believe it's called The Lovers. It's my favorite painting. And they have sheets on their faces and they're kissing. Okay. And it's this same exact setup, but they have sheets on their heads and they're actually kissing. It's the most sterile, creepy painting I've ever seen. And I've always been inspired. I thought it was one of those, I pretty much thought it was the most powerful image I had ever seen. So I said I wanted something kind of without the sheets, but very sterile and, you know, just like there's no love in it, but there kind of is. And just two people that are obviously separated by death.
Wow. That's, you know. That's heavy, dude. And then tell me about this girl that is obviously dead. and there's an autopsy being done. Am I right?
Yeah, well, she's pretty much in the autopsy room. That's probably a pretty fresh body. That's a shotgun wound to the chest that's pretty fresh. That's pretty much the end of the story, which is why I called the painting Just the Way It Goes. It's pretty much what happens in the end, more or less, without giving too much away. He comes back to get her, and she's pretty much doesn't get what he wants out of it. Obviously, she's not really alive.
On the back cover of the CD, you guys are starring in the movie My Chemical Romance.
Yeah, we set it up like a movie poster. All the posters, promotional posters, were set up like a movie poster. The video is done like a movie trailer, even though the movie has nothing to do with this story. You know, and that's pretty much, yeah. Like, the back cover's letterboxed in a way. We just want a very cinematic feel.
Do you think it's good to question authority?
It's good to question anything, you know what I'm saying? Like you should always question what somebody's telling you to do, because it might not be for your best interest. But, yeah, I'd have to say yes.
You know, I agree with Mikey. Like, you have to question everything, especially authority, because if you don't and nobody kind of watches them... Like, who? It's almost like they're watching you, but who's watching them? And
yeah. Absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Yeah. And you always have to question things, especially if you think something's wrong, you know, down to security at a venue, which we always usually get along with, but that's the authority at a club, and sometimes they're wrong, and sometimes you have to stop a whole song just to let them know that, and you know, but sometimes the kids are wrong, sometimes there's a violent guy in the crowd that's causing problems for them. So, you know, it's good to question authority.
Tell me about the two music videos and who came up with the concept for each and name them.
We actually have had four videos total.
We've had quite a few.
We made the first one ourselves for Vampires Will Never Hurt You. Kind of all did that, us and the Eyeball Guys. We built the sets and we wanted it to look like Cabin of Dr. Caligari, but we didn't quite have enough room in the room we were shooting in, so you don't see a lot of the set. But we're really happy with it. And then we shot a video for Honey, This Mirror Isn't Big Enough for the Two of Us. And it was a ripoff of this movie called Audition, this Japanese horror movie that I had loved. And then we made the live video for Not Okay, which was Craig Aronson's idea and concept, was to kind of capture us just a day in the life. And that was supposed to only really be used for the web, but then all the stations started playing it, and we're not going to tell them not to.
Yeah, exactly.
It was basically like a placeholder for the time being. And then we shot the video that Mark Webb did, and that was basically the concept of Mark Webb was to make it look like a movie trailer, and that's what attracted us to it. And we collaborated at that point. We had wanted to do some... He wanted to do high school, we wanted to do prep school. So it was a lot of compromise, but it was good compromise. It was the kind where it was like, how about this? Well, how about this? And we both got what we wanted. It's really, a lot of it's really his vision, you know, but he listened to us at the same time and let us do what we wanted, and we kind of wanted this dark, like the movie Heathers or something, to kind of have this, that's why there's a croquet scene in it, and we wanted to feel like that movie Rushmore, just kind of this dark humor, like school thing. Not Okay, the movie one, is, I think, debuting like tomorrow.
Yeah, it just got added like today or yesterday or something to Fuse and MTV.
I'm sure a lot of your fans are wondering if after you finish touring or while you're touring right now, are you shooting any footage for a live DVD? Because it would be great to see you guys in that format.
We're actually shooting all the time. We shot all of Warped.
Yeah, all of Warped Tour, and like the whole like week of our record coming out is on video. Like,
we shot all that.
We shot it all, yeah.
So maybe something will come together then.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think, especially the way Craig is, our A&R at Warner, he's amazing. And he always wants us, he's kind of like the dad that always wants you to have that video. And you're like, no, I don't want to tape it. And he's like, come on, you're going to want this in like 2 years.
Yeah.
And he's like that. And so we've kind of gotten used to it now, whereas we're taping everything and saving it and see what to do.
Well, so you're going to find out that you're not Dorian Gray, because when you look back at these videotapes, you're going to be like, dude, I had more hair back then.
Yeah, definitely. I'm definitely going to think I had a lot more hair back then. I'm like, you know.
What about this? What about that's when I was dating so-and-so?
Yeah.
This really sucks.
There's some stuff on there that I think it's all pretty cool. But it has our good shows and our bad shows, you know. There's some days on Warped where I walk off stage and our camera guy, Sim, he would always ask me every time I came off, how was that? And some days I'd be like, I don't want to talk about it. You know?
There's no way you can be on 100% of the time when you're going on tour. There's just because you're going to wake up some morning and just feel like I'm nauseous or whatever.
Yeah, well, and you know, when you're playing between the hours of 11:30 and 7 o'clock at night, and you don't know when you're playing, and then it kind of gets thrown at you. You don't know if you're going to be good that day, you know? But it's really up to the crowds, I think, at that point.
What's the excitement level for you as far as adrenaline before you hit the stage?
It's pretty unmatched, like nothing ever. Especially when you come out and you hear a roar or something. That's huge. That's, like, the best feeling. I used to get a lot more nervous than I did now, but... You know, it's crazy. I can't have conversations before. I mean, once on Warped, I was peeing, and all of a sudden I heard my guys start making feedback noise. I had to run out. My pants were, like, half off, and it was pretty funny. But, like, you know, I feel bad because people sometimes, like, backstage, they'll be like, hey, what's up? And they'll try to talk to me, and it'll be, like, 10 minutes before I'm going on, and I can't, like, really look at anybody.
Yeah.
So you get all nervous and stuff.
No, and then you a lot of times you get the rap of being, this guy's uncool or this guy's not. But they don't understand, hey, this is a job. This is what I do.
You gotta get into, like, a mindset before you go on.
It's like
a zone you get into.
You really have to.
Totally. Yeah. I totally agree. So now what is your mission statement?
Well, basically, we've always, you know, been the band that wants to save people's lives. And we're not in it for money or being a rock star or anything like that, or groupies and crap like that. We're really there to be there for people that need us musically. Like, the music really should be there for people. And our message has always been to keep yourself alive, you know, and help somebody who needs saving.
Now, have either of you ever been to the point where suicide has ever crossed your mind at all?
Well, I think it's crossed everybody's mind. It's just depending on how seriously it crosses your mind. I mean, I think the thought just alone of it pops into anybody's head, especially if it's somebody that's obsessed with death like me. I mean, you're always thinking about morbid things. But very, very rarely has it ever gotten, you know, to that point. I mean, I quit drinking because of that, so, and pills and everything, you know.
Mikey?
It's never crossed my mind at all. I'm so scared of death that, you know, like, I think we're all on this earth for a real limited amount of time, and I don't know why anyone would want it to be even less, you know? You're only here for, like, 70, sometimes, you know, like, even less, you know?
Yeah.
60 years. And it's, like, it's really abbreviated, so, like, we don't know. Nothing's guaranteed, you know? You don't know what's going to happen. So
exactly.
When you die, you know.
What doesn't kill you only makes you stronger.
That's very true. And, you know, that's kind of at the point where I'm at right now, where I feel really strong. I feel the band's stronger than it's ever been.
And your life is a witness to other kids that are out there, where, like you're saying, your whole mission statement is to keep people alive. Let them know, hang on. Mm-hmm. Think about jumping. Wait till tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly. You know? The most you could ever say is wait till tomorrow, really.
Yeah.
You know? And just hope it gets better.
What inspired the song? It's not a fashion statement. It's a f***ing death wish.
Well, basically, what inspired it is a number of things. It was the first song we wrote for this record. It encompassed the whole plot line in one song. It was kind of, you know, so we always knew that song no matter what was going to be on the record. It was kind of a way of us, the title was a way of us saying, like, this is not, like, a look. This is not some fashion we're trying to sell you. This is what we do, this is who we are, this is how we live, and this is what we're here to say. And so that song title was always, like, you know, really cool to me. I always loved that one. And because there was a lot of fashion going on at that point, and still to this day, where it was kind of almost to the point where it was, like, poser like where it was like, if you threw on a black t-shirt and some eyeliner or something, that all of a sudden made you this subgenre, and it would sell you records, you know?
Yeah.
And you see it even now.
What does the name Chemical Romance mean to you?
To me, it started off as, it means a couple things. It almost very literally, it means, you know, a romance with any kind of chemicals like alcohol or antidepressants like I had struggled with. It also kind of has, like, this true romance vibe, like this kind of Bonnie and Clyde feeling to it. If you read Irvine Welsh's novels, which is where the name came from, it's got that kind of vibe going on in them. Just not so much Bonnie and Clyde, but these kind of 20-year-olds that feel very dead you know, just struggling with chemical dependency. I think, well, Coke's coming back huge.
Yeah, I'm hearing that now.
Because it's like this 80s, like, this whole wave of 80s-ness or retro throwbacks going on. So all these bands are popping up that are like, they think it's the 80s still. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're not sure if it's the 80s.
So now we have to do Coke too?
Right.
Yeah, everything that comes with it. Coke and really bad haircuts and
and Hulk like Hogan,
spandex,
Mr.
It's T. All coming back.
That's crazy. So what's next for My Chemical Romance?
Finish out this tour sometime in November. I believe around November, December, we're doing some radio shows. We get Christmas off. We're going to the UK again and Japan in the new year. And then I think we're finally going to do our own tour in about February.
What kind of venues do you think you're going
to
be playing?
Oh, it's hard to tell at this point. I think metro-like venues.
Yeah.
If you know what the metro
mid-level
is.
Mid-level rooms, probably.
Kind of mid-level rooms, yeah.
Like bigger than the Roxy here in LA?
Oh yeah, probably.
Yeah. I don't know. Bigger than the Roxy.
It's when they project tours, it's like there's so many different factors that go into it. Like we just like our single just went to radio, like our video just got added, so we don't know if
you know. It could be smaller, bigger. You don't know.
How is MTV2 treating you and
right? Everybody's been giving us love.
The video without kind of asking, which is what you want. I mean, like, you don't want to tell them not play it, but it was like this live video, and we love it, but like, it's a live video, and like, we'd shot a real one, and they were already playing this one. We're like, whoa, that's awesome.
Hungry.
Yeah, they wanted it. Like, we told them to wait. I think nobody told them to wait, but somebody had suggested to them, well, the new video is almost done. Why don't you wait a week? And they're like, we can't wait. And that's really great, you know, for them to say.
All right. Well, hey, it's been great talking to you, Gerard. Mikey Way. All right, this is the Blaring Out with Eric Blair show with My Chemical Romance. Signing off. Bye-bye.
The Blaring Out show.